my channel and welcome back to 21st Century Literature class. And for today's topic, we will be dealing with contextual reading approaches under sociocultural context. So, let's begin. And for today's lesson, we will be dealing with lesson number 5 that talks about contextual reading approaches under literary reading through a sociocultural context. So, let's proceed. So, let's have first content standard under this lesson. The learner will be able to understand and appreciate the elements and context of 21st century Philippine literature from the regions. While for the performance standard, we do have the learner will be able to demonstrate, understand, and appreciate 21st century Philippine literature from the regions through a written close analysis and critical interpretation of a literary text in terms of form and theme, with a description of its context derived from research. So these are the most essential learning competencies as we go on and learn the lesson. First, identify the different ways one may evaluate a literary text, specifically by examining its sociocultural context, and discuss how different contexts enhance the text's meaning and enrich the reader's understanding. So this is the guide question that will guide us along our way as we learn lesson number 5. So why would a particular event or an outside situation affect a literary piece? So these are the topics to be learned under this lesson. First, what is sociocultural context? Second, what are the reasons to read literature through sociocultural context? Third, what are the guide questions that you may use to answer when you are reading literature through the sociocultural context? Next, what are the sociocultural perspectives or theories? Next, what is expected output as you finish this lesson? And how to write a short critical analysis essay? And lastly, tips for writing critical analysis. So let's proceed. So as we go on with our lesson, let's identify first the meaning of sociocultural context. What is sociocultural context? Sociocultural context is basically the events happened from a certain situation or from a certain story that affects the whole story, that affects the perspective of the author. So this is the social, economical, political, and cultural events happened in the story. Okay? So these are the following reasons why do we need to read literature through sociocultural context, according to Gia and Kennedy 2007. First, you need to read and identify and learn the sociocultural context because it helps you understand the social, economic, political, and cultural forces affecting the work that you are reading. In a certain literary work, the issues presented affects the whole story and how the story revolves, and at the same time the character is revolving in the story. Another, when you try to read the sociocultural context, is you try to analyze also the sociocultural context of the text that makes you examine the role of the audience in shaping literature. In short, you try to understand the purpose of the writer when he presented it into the literary work, and you try to understand also what will be the role of the audience when he tries to watch or read the story and tries to critique on it, and then tries to imbibe the point of view of the author presented in the story or into another literary work. Okay? So these are the guide questions that you may answer when you are reading literature through sociocultural context. So as you go on and try to read the story and try to look into the sociocultural context, meaning the events happen in the story, these are your guided questions. First, What is the relationship between the characters or the speakers in the text and their society? What is the relationship of the characters into the situation? What is the relationship of the point of view of the character into the situation? So you try to relate what is happening in the story if you know what is the issue presented in the story. Okay, so you try to connect the dots of one situation to another situation and another situation and try to incorporate the characters in it. Okay, next one is about, does the text explicitly address issues or of gender, race, or class? How does the text resolve these issues? In some stories, they try to point out some issues about gender discrimination, racial discrimination, or even the class itself. What do you mean by class? Class discrimination in terms of poor versus rich. Okay, so or your class into the society. And after presenting, or after the author presented that one into a literary form, do you think that from the point of view of the author, does it resolve the issue? Or from the purpose of the author giving it to the reader, does it resolve the issue or the event? Does it change your perspective of understanding the concept or understanding the situation itself? So that's it. Another, who has the power and who does not? What is the reason for this setup? What do you think is the point where the literary work is circling? And what are the characters portrayed by different characters? And what is the power of the characters to the another character? Okay, and why do you think the setup is like that? And why do you think the point of view of the writer is like that? Okay, so try to look into the interconnectedness of each situation from the character, and from that point of view you will understand where does this author coming from. Okay, so another guide question that may also help you when you're reading literature through sociocultural context is this one. How does this story reflect the nation? What does this say about the country and its inhabitants? Okay, so if the situation is presented into a certain literary work, do you think the nation will try to condemn what is into the situation presented, or what is the perspective of the author? Does it really reflect what really happened? And do you think what will be the opinion of the country and the people of the country if this is presented to the reader? Do you think it is the real scenario that happened way back then? Another, who has the economic or social power? Is there oppression or class struggle? How do the characters overcome this? Does money or finances play a large role in the narrative? Like for example, in the story of El Filibusterismo and Noli Me Tangre, which is the author is Jose Rizal. And you know for a fact that Jose Rizal experienced oppression from the Spaniards. So, as you look into the story of El Filibusterismo and Noli Me Tangre, you will see there that there is a social power, economic power, and power of administration coming from the Spaniards. So, you will see that also into the characters. Paano? In terms of yung mga characters doon ay sunod-sunuran, and at the same time, natatakot sila to fight for their rights, to fight for their freedom because they are being oppressed. Okay? So, does money or finances play a large role in the narrative? Do you think what are the things that come up with that situation or that event? What triggers the situation to happen? Another, what is the prevailing social order? Chaotic ba yung situation? Medyo magulo ba? Kaya nagkaroon ng ganong sitwasyon? In some stories, as you look into martial law era, may mga storya na where they incorporated what really happened katulad namang ng dekada 70. Okay? So does the story or poem accept or challenge it? Do you think that the story presented to the readers are being accepted? What do you mean by accepted? Naniniwala ba sila do sa point of view ni writer? Or tumataliwas doon sa point of view ni writer na hindi naman talaga totoong nangyayari yun? Understand? So, nagkakaroon ng collision of ideas and collision of belief and point of view if it is being presented to the reader. Okay? So, try to look into that. Okay? So, next topic that we're gonna be talking about is about the sociocultural perspective. What is sociocultural perspective? Sociocultural perspective are basically the events that happened to different literary works wherein they are classified. Okay? So, what events from those literary works are they into? What classification of those events from different perspective? Okay? So, next, the first one that we have is Marxism. So, Marxism, according to Marx's perspective, because Marx is the author itself of the Marxism, Marx said that when we talk about Marxism, the literature shows class struggle and materialism. And it looks into the social classes portrayed in the work, and it also looks into how the text serves as a propaganda material, and it also examines oppression, social conflict, solution to the struggles as shown in the literary work. So here at Marxism, if it talks about oppression, or if it uses or the literary work is used as a propaganda material to awaken the minds of the readers or the minds of the people, that is Marxism. Okay? So try to look into the theme of the event. Okay? What particular theme or particular idea is happening into the event. So next one is feminism. With the word feminism, femi, wherein it talks about female. So if the literary work is presenting to you discrimination about women or the role of women in the literature, or the role of the female character being empowered or being discriminated, that is feminism. So, feminism theory is presented into the literary work. If the topics are into discrimination, or the events into the literary work is about discrimination about women, or there is an empowerment of women into the literary work. Okay? So, next one is queer theory. What is queer theory? The queer theory is about the queer perspective is concerned with the queer of the third gender. This perspective itself was named in 1991 under this perspective. The third gender, meaning the gay, lesbians, and other characters or persona in literature that may fall under queer, are being examined. Here, if the subject of being talked about or the events happen in the story has a relationship and perspective of LGBT, this is queer theory. Okay? Next one is about historicism. Historicism comes from the word history. So in short, the concept talks about perspective dealing with history that influenced the writing of literature. So, for example, the story of General Luna, Goyo, wherein the writer is being influenced in incorporating what happened way back then and present it again but into another perspective, that is historicism. Okay? Next one is post-colonialism. What is post-colonialism? Post-colonialism is basically, this is a literary perspective that looks into the changes into the attitude of the post-colonies after the colonial period. Through this perspective, the dependence or independence of decolonized countries or people are being examined. Post-colonialism is basically, this is the situation or events we're in after colonization. What are the attitudes of the people or what changes into the events when after colonization? Okay? So, do we become independent? And do we become free of speech, free of our decisions, free of our actions? So that's post-colonialism. So this is the transition from being colonized to being free. Okay? Next one is new historicism. So what is new historicism? New historicism is basically another perspective in the socio-cultural context. It focuses not only on the history when the literary text was written, but also how the history happened in new historicism. The above mentioned perspective can be integrated with each other. This is where there's a present situation interconnected with the past. Alright? So, for example, the story of Corazon, ang unang aswang, na the situation is like this because it is interconnected with the history way back then. Okay? So, from the present situation, kaya nangyayari yung isang sitwasyon because of the past. Okay? So, that is what you mean by new historicism. So, the expected output for this lesson number 5, is a critical analysis. So particularly, you're going to a critical analysis essay, particularly you're going to recall a movie that you have watched in your previous history or literature class, or a story that you have read or watched way back when the COVID is in trend, though it's still in trend, but you have lots of time to watch movies, to read stories, or read books. So from that, you try to look into and write a short analysis about the movie using an appropriate literary perspective. Okay? So here is the key. As you look into and make a critical analysis essay, and these are the steps. Before writing a short critical analysis essay, make sure that you have researched first your movie read. The movie that you have watched or the story that you have read. Understand? Hindi pwedeng mag-jump ka kaagad sa pagsulat kung wala ka pang idea sa utak or hindi ka pa nakakapag-research ng social perspective or issue presented into the story. Ang tatandaan, ang pinupunto doon sa inyong critical analysis essay is the socio-cultural perspective presented into the story. Understand? So, paano mo malalaman yung socio-cultural perspective ng isang istorya kung hindi ka magre-research? They always remember, don't just look information from one website, lalo na ngayon, hindi naman kayo pwedeng maglibro. So, your one source of information is the Google. So, just don't just look into one website. Try to look into other websites so that you will know their different perspective into the movie that you have watched or the story that you have read. So after that, kunyari nakapag-collate ka na ng information from the different websites about the socio-cultural perspective of that story that you have read or a movie that you have watched, that's the time that you're going to create an outline. So, here and then write an introduction, write your body, conclude your critical analysis, and then proofread and refine your work. So, to further understand it, let's have first create an outline. So, what is creating an outline? So, after the ideas that you have gathered from the different website or from the different sources of information that is related to your story read or movie that you have watched. This time, you're going to create an outline. I know you're very familiar with creating an outline because way back in your EAPP and reading and writing, you have already done that, okay? I think some of you did the sentence outline or the phrase outline or the topic outline like that. So I know you're very familiar with that. But here, I will not let you make it complicate things. So you're just going to create a bullet point outline, noting the main points you will make. So think critically about the work you're analyzing and its important parts when creating your outline. You will refer to your outline throughout the writing process to stay focused. Consider any structure and length requirements for your critical analysis when writing your outline. Now, I know you know what is the importance of outline, but I want to reiterate this importance because as you go on with writing your critical analysis essay, your outline is like the fishbone of your critical analysis essay. So, paano mo kakainin yung laman ng isda kung wala siyang butong pangahawakan? What do I mean by that? Yung buto will be your basis on what meat or what content are you going to put into different branches of that fish. So, yung whole fish, yun yung mismong buong critical analysis essay nyo. Now, from that fishbone, ano ang ilalagay ninyo sa bawat branch ng fishbone na yun so that the topic and the critical analysis essay is organized. Another, the importance of making an outline also will help you to do the critical analysis essay ng hindi sabog. I mean, hindi sabog yung idea at hindi pa ulit-ulit, okay? Kasi the more na pinapaulit-ulit nyo yung isang idea, the more na hindi siya masarap basahin. Kasi marami kang point na gusto mong ibigay. Hindi na ma-decipher or hindi na maintindihan at the same time, nakakaumay, okay? So para hindi maumay ang readers and audience, make sure that the outline that you try to make an outline for your critical analysis essay so that you will know where are you going to, okay? And what information are you going to put into your essay, okay? So that's the importance of creating an outline. Para hindi pati kayo na wiwindang and at the same time, madali sa inyong ipatch yung information, madali sa inyong ilagay, okay? And at the same time, kapag may outline kayo, hindi kayo mahihirapang sumulat ng introduction, body, and conclusion kung may outline kayo. So, in your outline also, you will look into what are the things that you will write into your body, into your introduction, body, and then conclusion, okay? Next one that you're going to do after writing an outline, you have already the topics to be presented and then points to be clarified and present. This is the time that you're going to write your introduction already. Most of the time and usually, ang introduction ay maikli. Why? Because your introduction is basically siniset mo lang yung mind ng readers. So, why are you setting the mind of the reader? So, parang yun ay yun yung summary. And yun yung bagong entrada. So, hindi mo pa ibibigay yung pagkain sa kanya. Hindi mo pa ibibigay yung buong content. Sa introduction, you're just going to point what are you going to discuss for the whole essay. Okay? So, here, you're going to write a section that introduces your audience to the work you are analyzing and your opinions about it. It should define the original creator's aim or thesis statement and main ideas and finish with your thesis statement. 3 or 4 sentences is a good length for most critical analysis introduction, but it may be several paragraphs for more complex critical analysis. Focus on making your introduction engaging to attract your audience's attention and encourage them to continue listening or reading your critical analysis. So, the requirement for your critical analysis essay is it should be a 3-paragraph essay. Okay? A minimum of 3-paragraph essay. It depends on what points do you want to present to us. Okay? So, next one is body. Okay? So, after before we go to body, I know you have different styles and I know your reading and writing teacher and EAPP teacher already told you about what are the different styles in writing an introduction. Like, for example, it can either you try to post a question, or you can try to put a quote first, an anecdote. It depends on you, okay? So, try to look into the ways or styles on how to write an introduction. Next one is about writing your body. If the introduction is the ulo or the head of a critical essay, the next one is the body. So, ibig sabihin, as you will see, yung body yung pinaka malaking part ng iyong katawan or ng isang essay. Why? Because this is the whole content. The points that you want to clarify. The points that you want to present to the audience. The points that you want to present to the reader. So, when you're writing a body, make sure that you address the main points outlined in your introduction. So, dun sa, as what I have told you, sa introduction, ang bibigay mo lang dyan sa amin, summary. Summary ng ipapakain na content or ipapabasa mong content sa amin. So, 2 to 4 body paragraphs is common, but you may have more or fewer paragraphs depending on any writing guidelines you have received. Each body paragraph should focus on a single idea. Okay? So, state the idea in the first sentence and support the idea with examples from the work you are analyzing. You may incorporate quotes from the original source that support your claims. Remember to add consistently formatted citation to any quotes you include. Okay? So, that's why I ask you to look into different websites from their point of view. Kasi hindi pwedeng ang inyong i-present lang sa akin ay basically an opinion. Kasi kung yan ay opinion at based on your emotion, reflective essay lang siya. Hindi siya critical analysis essay. Pag sinabing critical analysis essay, you try to analyze your point of view from others' point of view. And from others' point of view, that's the time that you're going to make a conclusion out of it. You try to make judgment from their point of view. Na hindi lang sa isa magagaling, kundi sa iba. Okay? So, next one is about conclusion or concluding statement. So, the third part of your critical analysis essay is the conclusion. So, here at the conclusion, ito ay pinapakita na kung ano ang stand mo. Stand mo about the situation, about the points of the different writers from the story that you have read or watched. So, when you write a conclusion, try to restate your perspective. It should build on the statements in your body paragraphs to bring your critical analysis to a natural stopping point. Here, kailangan magbigay ka ng impact dun sa reader. Ano bang gusto mong maibigay dun sa reader? Ano bang gusto mong i-end para sa reader? So, what realization have you thought of and have you thought about the topic or about the story that you have read based on different perspective from the different authors about their views from the story that you have read? So, it will have similar content to your introduction, but it should be expressed in a different way. So, 2 to 4 sentences is sufficient for most conclusion, but the conclusions of some complex critical analysis, some may have multiple paragraphs. Okay? So, kaya nga sinabing critical analysis, you try to read beyond and think beyond what you see and what you read into the story or into the movie. Now, after writing the conclusion, so malamang buo na yung inyong critical analysis essay, make sure that you have the last part. proofread and refine your work. What do you mean by proofread? Proofread is about you try to read your critical analysis to ensure it's sound, as professional as it should. Correct any spelling and grammatical errors if you see an awkward phrasing when you say it. Read your critical analysis out loud because it will help you identify more areas for improvement. Doing this step a few hours or even a few days after you write your critical analysis, if you have time, can also be more effective. You may also proofread and refine your work as many times as you need to until you are satisfied with your critical analysis. So if you need extra input, you may also ask for a trusted colleague, friend, or professional editor to proofread your work. Their objective perspective can identify more errors and help make your critical analysis even better. But since pandemya ngayon, you can just ask from your mother or father kung wala silang kakainan, you can just ask your classmates or sisters that they have knowledge in terms of putting it in a piece of paper. Okay? So, that's the importance of proofreading. Para hindi man, pero kapag niligay nyo yun sa laptop, I'm sure na de-detect na ni laptop kung may problema sa spelling, may problema sa subject-verb agreement. So, it will be easy, okay? So, next one is about this one. What are the tips for writing critical analysis? You need to have first cross-reference your outline. I know you're very familiar with cross-referencing. It was discussed into your EAPP and practical research. What do you mean by cross-reference? Cross-reference is basically you try to cross-reference from one material or from one source to another source and another source and another source to show consistency of the ideas or kung meron bang inconsistencies of the ideas. That's why you try to need to dig into the reference that you are the information that you're getting. Okay, so referring to your outline through the writing process help you stay focused and cover all the points you intended. Yun yung maganda kapag naka-outline. So lahat ng ideas, kunyari lang the ideas mo ay about oppression dun sa certain story, so lahat ng idea mo ay nandito sa unang paragraph, pangalawang paragraph, pangatlong paragraph, tapos from different authors na may sagot sila sa oppression. Para sama-sama sila, hindi pwedeng iba-iba. Okay? So next one is about using transitional words and phrases. So what is the importance and what is the beauty of transitional words and phrases? Transitional words and phrases such as therefore and in addition help your sentences and paragraph flow and create connection between the ideas. It doesn't only, hindi lang nako-connect niya yung ideas, but at the same time, nakikita mo kung paano mo pinagsasama-sama yung ideas o kino-compare or dinedebate yung bang dinedifferentiate yung one idea from another idea. At the same time, nakikita mo yung smooth flow of ideas and organization if you use transitional words and phrases. So, you may try to look into the website or into Google what are the examples of transitional words and phrases, like, for example, yung nga, yung therefore, in addition, but, and, what else? Likewise, thus, hence, like that. So, another also tip for writing critical analysis is be concise. So, hindi ko kailangan yung paikot-ikutin nyo ako, pero gusto nyo lang din naman sabihin mahal nyo ako. Okay? So, diba parang ano yun eh, parang kapag naliligaw ka, ang mga babae, ayaw nila nung pinaiikot-ikot mo siya kasi the more na pinaiikot-ikot mo, the more na hindi nagiging clear yung idea. That's why, make it short, but meaty. Okay? So, that's being concise. So, writing succinctly makes your writing clear and more persuasive. Kasi pag pinaikot-ikot mo siya, lalo mong ginugulo yung reader. At the same time, lalong pinapahaba mo lang yung sentences. Okay? So, pinapahaba mo lang yung idea, pero ang gusto mo lang namang sabihin ay ganito. Okay? So, parang yan, kapag naliligaw ka, ang dami, kasi, ano, parang hindi ako makatulog kapag, ano, kapag nakikita kita, oh, ganon, kasi hindi ako makakain, ganon. Eh, yung pala gusto mo lang sabihin na mahal kita. Okay? So, marami ka pang ginawang cheche-bureche and anek-anek. So, why don't you be straight and be concise, short but meaningful. Another is write logically. So, write logically is about what? Your critical analysis should be organized in a way that makes sense with ideas that naturally flow. Hindi mo pwedeng pagsamasamahin ang idea na magkataliwas. Okay? So, kunyari, ang una mong diniscuss muna ay yung oppression, sumunod ay about society, sumunod ay about political, and then be it. Huwag mong pagsasamahin kasi mas magugulahan yung reader of what you want to tell to them. Okay? So, always remember that you try to look into the perspective of the reader. Try to look into the position of the reader. Na kahit na simpleng tao lang maiintindihan yung point mo. Okay? Lalo na yan eh kapag mga, lalo na yan eh pag essay or critical analysis essay. Na ang purpose mo is maintindihan nila yung point of view mo. Unlike kasi ang POM kasi is more of figurative language. So, my interpretation is different from his interpretation and another interpretation. So, okay lang yun. But with a critical analysis essay, eto, ang point of view nito ay you need to be heard, you need to be understood into the different points that you have presented. So, parang ano to, parang ina-encourage mo sila to see what you see. Okay? Next one is write in third person. So, what do you mean by writing in third person? I know you're very familiar with this one kasi pag nagsusulat kayo ng research paper, you're trying to use third person. So, ang first person, ayun yung mga I, mga we, second person, the she, the he. But here, third person, you're not addressing yourself. So, palaging ang gamit ay the author, ano pa, as you see, people will, ganon. So, instead of I, you try to look into other perspective and the third point of view as you present it in your critical analysis essay. Okay? So, that's it for lesson number 5, the discussion for lesson number 5. And at the same time, the things that you, for clarification for your written output in lesson number 5. So, I want to end my lesson for the following quote from Jeanette Walls by Half Bro Courses, that sometimes something catastrophic can occur in a split second that changes a person's life forever. Other times, one minor accident can lead to another and then another and another, eventually setting off just as a big change in a body's life. So, if you're gonna be looking into the concept of the quote of Jeanette Walls, everything happens for a reason. Everything is interconnected with each other. It may be bad or it may be good. Just be thankful that it happened to you. Not being thankful that it happened to you, but what I mean is try to look into a perspective of you are being blessed that the happenings of your life makes you and made you who you are right now. That's why I want to end my discussion as try to have a good purpose of your life in this earth. Try to put your actions as what purpose you have in your life as a person and for your family and for the people. So now, what have you done to put your life in a purpose set by God? Are you still working on it? Or are you making yourself a better person? Okay, so have a nice day and stay safe, everyone. Goodbye. And we'll see I'll see you again for my next lesson. Bye-bye. Stay safe. We'll be right back.
today.